Mr. Sturla Sigurjonsson for giving us the history and the context of Nordic Baltic 8 partnerships. Now, we're going to begin our discussions on security. So what I'm going to do is I will invite our three speakers to the stage. They're each going to speak for 10 minutes, and after that we'll have opportunity for discussion and questions. I'd be delighted to take as many questions as possible from the floor. So if there is a question that you think of during a presentation, make a note of it, and after the three presentations, we'll hopefully get opportunity to discuss all of those themes. So if I can invite our three speakers, and I'll introduce them as they come up, but if you can come on this side, sorry. Kirsti, Narinen, Kirsti, if you'd like to stay here because you're here talking.
Right, thank you.
Thank you. So just while we get our presentations ready, unfortunately, this issue of security, we could talk about it for the whole bank holiday weekend, but we only have until 10:30. So our speakers only have 10 minutes, and that is a very short amount of time to get through everything that they want to do. Hopefully it would be enough to prompt our discussions and to talk through the large themes that we will have. Roisin is here in the front row, so she'll be telling our speakers how much time they have left. And I'd now like to welcome our first speaker, who, as I said, is Miss Kirsti Narinen. She is the Director of International Relations at the European Centre of Excellence for Countering Hybrid Threats. And her talk today is on the changing character of peace, the landscape of hybrid threats. So as our first speaker, please give Miss Kirsti Narinen a round of applause.
Thank you. It's very generous of you to applause before I've even opened my mouth. Thank you very much for the support and the pressure. NB8 is one of my favorite formats of international politics. I've been the Finnish ambassador to Estonia for 5 years. I've lived there also in the 90s for 4 years, and I lived there in the 90s for 5 years, so I lived there 9 years. I was the first Baltic desk officer in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 1992, and I followed the independence process from Leningrad, 1990-1992. Plus, I learned my Swedish in Tallinn, where the Nordic cooperation was very, very intense in the 90s, and not less in this decade. I work presently at the European Centre of Excellence for Countering Hybrid Threats, which might be an organization that some of you know. I'm not going to concentrate on the center, however, today, because the sales and marketing department of the center is closed for the moment, as we are receiving so many new members that we will now concentrate on absorbing the ones that we have. So Iceland, Ireland, you are more than welcome to join, but this is not for this purpose. The purpose is to talk about the changing character of peace and about the concept of hybrid threats. I mean, we hear the word quite often, yet there seems to be very little, not understanding, but conceptualization, that what are we actually talking about. I'd like to refer to a speech of Antonio Missiroli, the Assistant Secretary General of NATO, in Helsinki Conference on Hybrid Threats that we had earlier this week. And he said that, "I drive hybrid car, the pedestrians don't hear when I appear. Oh, they only see me when I'm there." True, which means that you have to use all your senses, your 360 degrees, to observe the elements of society around you. That's one. And in order to hear, you also need to listen. So, we are not talking about anything new. I mean, this is something that we've always had in societies. During the Cold War period, there were so many things that were happening around us. Party financing was an everyday feature. Disinformation using the fifth column was used everywhere. The use of your fellow countrymen and taking advantage of them was everyday business. So why is it so topical now? There are a few reasons that are there. First of all, the changing world order after the Cold War. We all figured out that the Western regime that won the Cold War would prevail, and then we would live happily ever after. Well, that didn't quite take place. And that has resulted in power transition from the West. first away from West and to the fragmented world. The rise of China is a completely different, a new element in this debate. And this has also led to the fragmentation is leading to dividing lines in societies, which is bringing this fragmentation to the national and domestic fora. Technological revolution has changed that all, and that has brought us a lot of prosperity, wealth, speed, reliability, transparency, so we should never say that digitalization should be stopped. It cannot be stopped, but it has brought the cyber threats along with it. That has also brought the changes in media landscape, which means that the connectivity, not only regionally, but also ideologically and globally, has brought a completely new platforms for the adversaries or the malign influencing that was not there before. And the climate change is not only bringing the anxiety in society, like Mr. Minister, you were referring to. The point that Mr. Minister was referring to was the point that generations don't understand each other and the expectations are different and changing. Climate change is also bringing the physical vulnerabilities of societies. If there's a forest fire, flood, storm, the authorities are under stress. If you add on a cyber attack and a few successful disinformation campaigns, you would have the questions asked that why do not the authorities do anything, which is undermining the trust to societies and its actors. And this is bringing the dividing lines into societies, states, regions, generations, ideologies, and this is very fertile ground for outside influencing, very, very fertile ground. And this has brought us to the concept of modern conflict. Conflicts are different than it has ever been, they have ever been before. And this all needs to be put into the historical, political, economic, geographic, cultural context, so the same action in one context is considered to be very different than in another one. Let's take the immigration issue. The borderline of Finland was opened by Russia in 2015 autumn. Finland and Norway, who are completely almost as similar as countries can be, examined and analyzed the situation in a different way, based to the fact that our political history with Russia is so different. One was talking about corrupt border guard, and Finland talked about hybrid influencing, testing rather. So this needs to be taken into account, and this means that we have to know what the historic and economic and etc. context of your country is. So hybrid threat, it's a Western concept. It's coordinated and synchronized. If you have a look at our logo, I think it's all there. I hope that would kind of carve into your minds that there are red spots that are connected with each other. That's hybrid threat. So multifaceted, multi-actor, coordinated, synchronized action. You have to make the difference between that and the individual red spots, which might be individual cyber attacks, disinformation campaigns, because they are more likely to be crime than anything else. However, sometimes cross-border connecting the dots would be the thing that we need to do, and that's what the Hybrid Center of Excellence is doing, so that we do not only look into our own societies and the actions taking place there, but also cross-border, because that's usually the case. It's exploiting the thresholds. Detection attribution, who's behind this action? Who was behind the bombing of the Saudi Arabian oil refinery? We still don't know. War and peace. There was war in Georgia. There's never been peace since. Internal, external. Internal threats are taken care of by police. External is military. Not the case anymore. Military, civil, public, private. Facts and fiction. This 0-1 world that we have lived in and what our computing is based on doesn't exist anymore. We are moving towards a world where friends and foes are not distinguished. Well, if a friend attacks a friend where a friend has left a region, where is the enemy? If we talk about North Syria as we speak. So this is what the world looks like today, and all these things are here to stay. And that's something where international coordination and cooperation is needed. And that main aim is to influence the decision-making bodies, local, state, institutional level, because they are the ones who make the decisions. And the aim is that we would ourselves make the decisions that are harmful to us and beneficial for the adversary. I will jump over that because of the time. That's the same thing, just in a visual format. You will get the slides later, so you can study that yourself. So also the military, if you look at the hybrid warfare, because this is something that is very often discussed, that warfare and hybrid threats are blurred also. Military-centric warfare is the one that you have the military attacking. This is the North Syria today. This has been the Falkland Islands War and many others. But the hybrid warfare means that all those tools are used in different concerted matters, like a Swiss knife, which is tailored and which is using the knife as a military tool, but also many others. These are the values with which we won the Cold War: democracy, democratic institutions, human rights, etc. These are also our vulnerabilities in certain occasions, and these are also the ones that the adversary will look into when they're trying to find the targets of malign action in our societies. In this family, Nordic, Baltic, Eight, and Ireland, and a few others, this is a very strong set of interests and values that we have. Not all countries have them, and the adversaries have none. This is why this group of experience and context is so vital to build our resilience and our future actions on. For that, to detect the threats, to respond to them, and with that deter, we need to be aware of the situation, we need to share information to build the situational awareness, we will be able to detect, we need to communicate, we need to be unified in doing that and showing the political will to counter and join our forces to do that. To conclude, we need to have the democratic values and we need to recognize that they need to be defended. They do not live without that anymore in the fragmentation of societies. We all have vulnerabilities because we tend to think that the strong Nordic countries are so strong that they can up anything. Not the case. We need to have rational, intellectually honest analysis for that. That's sometimes the tricky part. Cornerstones of democracy are challenged. We need to admit that. Comprehensive all-government approach is the only thing. If we have overarching threats, we need to have overarching response. And there's obviously a demand for joint action. And we feel that the hybrid COE, NB8, NB8 plus Ireland, be it then plus Germany, plus UK, plus the member states of our center, which you can see below, this is the reference group with which is the only way to build shared and joint security to these societies that we cherish so deep. Thank you very much.